Iya, oke. Sobat Dr. Vito, sekarang di DRV Channel, kita kedatangan tamu spesial. Ini seorang spesialis jantung dan pembuluh darah dari UK, North London. Dan kita akan sapa ya, Dr. Naderi. Beliau Dr. Hafiz Naderi. Dan kita akan kasih pengertian sekarang, edukasi, penjelasan mengenai hipertensi dan juga mengenai jantung pada umumnya. Beda nggak sih di luar negeri sama di Indonesia? Pastinya menarik banget kan? Kalau gitu langsung aja ya. Dr. Hafiz Naderi. Hi.
Hello, Dr. Vito. Thank you very much for inviting me to your channel.
The honor is mine. And then actually, we are very interesting to ask you more about how the heart disease condition in London, in UK, and where do you based, and then what are you doing now? I mean, so actually, Dr. Hafiz Naderi, I already read about your story, and then we already talked about this maybe a little bit before, and I know you're a cardiologist, but I think better if you explain to our audience, what are you doing now?
No, absolutely. So currently, I am a cardiology registrar. That's an equivalent to a resident, probably in Indonesia and the US. And currently, I am undertaking a period of research. I'm doing my PhD. And within cardiology, I'm subspecializing in cardiovascular imaging. So with focus on echocardiography in my initial years, and cardiac CT, and during my research, I'm focusing cardiac MRI.
Wow, okay, that's interesting because imaging cardiology is now like a rising star of cardiology. Yeah, that's right.
That's very kind of you. Very kind.
Yeah, okay. Please let me explain in Indonesian with our fellows. So, Dr. Naderi adalah seorang dokter jantung yang sekarang mendalami imaging kardiologi. Itu kayak periksa MRI, CT scan, dan lain-lain. Dan dia based di UK. Dia juga sekarang sedang melakukan penelitian, PhD ya, di bidang kardiologi, bidang jantung juga. So, actually, Dr. Naderi, what areas in cardiology really interest you? You already said about imaging cardiology, but cardiology is actually very broad. I mean, we are very broad range of the thing we have to learn. So what thing you really interest into?
Yes, I think within cardiology, I've been very fortunate to have worked in lots of different hospitals. So I started my training in the district general hospitals that were attached to A&E department or the emergency department. So I got to see a number of different pathologies. And in my last few years, I've been working in the tertiary centers. So hospitals that have access to heart attack centers and lots of imaging modalities available for my training. And within this period, I really developed an interest in endocarditis, because I think that lends itself very well to echocardiography, and more specifically to 3D echocardiography. And I was very fortunate to be supervised by consultants who were experts in that field during my time at Hammersmith. And as I was developing my PhD project, which is based around hypertension and high blood pressure, I really developed an interest in hypertension. And that's an area of cardiology that I'm also particularly interested in.
Well, it's very interesting because I just actually have a content education for people about endocarditis, and you just mentioned that you are interested in with endocarditis itself. So we will talk maybe more about endocarditis, but before that, we want the audience to really know you before that. So I actually found you really interesting to education to people, and then that's the maybe one of the same thing we really have in common. And then what do you think about education? I mean, why you are interesting to in online teaching, informing that?
So I got interested in online teaching in a roundabout way. So during COVID in the first wave, I had to delay my research, and I stayed in my in the current hospital that I was training at Hammersmith. And during that time, I was approached by a medical company to do online teaching for them related to COVID. And across the UK and many parts of the world, including the US, we were using handheld echocardiography at the time. And the rationale behind that was to reduce the contact with patients who had COVID and to keep the operator, the person doing the scan, safe. So we developed a protocol within the hospital. And I felt that was something worthwhile to share with the community. And I worked with the medical company MedMastery. So I worked very closely with them to develop that course with a quick turnaround, because we wanted people to have access to this new knowledge, this new information. And I really enjoyed the process. And actually, COVID has really shifted the landscape in terms of education. It's made it far more accessible. And I know through your social media outlets, you are a big believer on medical education. And I think that's how we initially connected, both of us believing that medical education online particularly can be so powerful. And I think one of the positive outcomes of COVID is making knowledge accessible. So I think that's where my interest started. And then following on from that, because I enjoyed the process so much, the company now asked me to do a second course for them. So that's something I'm working on. It's on 3D echocardiography, one of my other clinical interests. And as a result of that, because I enjoyed it so much, I decided to start my own YouTube channel.
Wow, yes, yes. So actually, that is really a positive side indeed of COVID-19. I mean, yeah, I know that UK is one of the big hit in COVID-19. And then, well, we are really very, very think that it's very low, very down. But we know that there's always a positive side. And then online teaching will connect us. And then we can share knowledge and already experience, sharing cases and many more, just like we want to do this afternoon. So what do you think that you have experience in online teaching now? And then what do you think is make a good online teacher?
Yeah, I think that's a really interesting question, because I think the most important thing, in my opinion, is to know your audience, know who you are speaking to. Because when I was teaching for MedMastery, it was for the medical community, so for medical students and doctors. And of course, the language you use is very different as to when you're communicating with the general public. So I learned a lot of new skills in public engagement and being very clear with the language and really engaging the audience so that it's simple, clear, easy to understand, but there was a clear message, which is why currently with my videos, I've kept them relatively short. I really do focus on what is it that I want the viewer to take away from them when they finish watching. If there is one message they remember, what is that going to be? So really, in answer to your question, I think the most important skill is really knowing the audience, who you're talking to, and just making it very clear and concise.
And then they will pay attention for that. And then perhaps they will be an influencer. I mean, your audience will share the content, the education content, to other people. And then they will become, well, a little bit supporting your education, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Because I think with online teaching, you get immediate feedback. You know, people can comment on your videos, what they like, and I get messages or what people would like to see in the future. So it's really starting to become a community. I mean, I've recently started, so my channel is very new. It started in April. But I would like to ask you, Dr. Vito, in your opinion, what have you learned from your experience in online teaching? What's something that you've taken away from it, from your experience?
Yeah, well, actually, I watch your YouTube channel, and then I think it's professionally made. I mean, you make it visualization, and then good visualization, and then it actually give the people, the viewers, the patient to do more. Okay, I mean, I want to watch it more. I want to watch it more because it's actually one of the important thing. I mean, if you just talk to the people and then you make it flat and you make it boring, I mean, the people will not catch your education content. So I think it's really important to make it to make innovation, to make improvisation. So it's actually a little bit a show when you give an education and then you give interesting ad and then maybe visualization and sound to make people really interesting to watch it until the end and then share the education. That's the purpose of education, right? To make people and more have the content, the idea, make it clean and clear about what your message, to make them healthy, to make them have maybe they want to have a healthy lifestyle and so on and so on. So yes, I think I like your content in your YouTube channel. What's your YouTube channel? You have to write it down, okay?
Yes, yeah, I'll provide you the link. I'm called The Heart Doctor. It's not very imaginative, but I thought it's very clear. And I think you are very correct, Dr. Vito, in saying that it is a visual medium, isn't it? So when you're recording the videos, you are on camera and you have to maintain somebody's attention for that period of time. And some topics in cardiology can be quite complicated. And how do I simplify that for a lay audience to appreciate it? And of course, the audience, they're not all lay people. They are doctors. There are doctors from other specialties potentially watching your work. So you have that added layer of making sure that, of course, it's scientifically accurate, that it's medically accurate, but also engaging. And because it's a visual medium, like you say, just making sure that you maintain engagement. And I think you do it brilliantly. And I think it's something that you have to evolve with time. And don't you find that another thing that is really important is to make sure that you sound like yourself? So I don't know about you, but I write my own scripts because I think it's really important to come across as you are naturally, because I think that's quite easier to maintain. What do you think about that? Do you think that's an important element as well?
Yes, that's very important element because you have to be honest to your audience, I mean your viewers, and then the real case, the real world case will be very interesting because it will be more relevant. I mean, you actually don't want to connect your audience with the textbook, I mean, or the journals actually, because there is a gap there. So you have to deliver the message as relevant as you can. So in my opinion, I will give my viewers with the real case. So example, if today I find out my patient have, for example, hypertension, heart disease with thickening of left ventricle and cardiac chamber, there is a heart failure there, so I will talk about that. So yeah, I think it's important thing to say. Yes,
yeah, completely agree.
So that's another way. If people want to interact with your YouTube channel, they can write on the comment and then you'll respond, or?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I do try to respond to as much as I can. And as you know, that it's quite challenging to give, in fact, I don't give medical advice, individual medical advice on the channel, because I think, you know, that's doing a disservice to the individual. I think it's important that these videos are seen as education only, and that if people are wanting to discuss something individual to them, that it's important to see their own doctor, because they'll have access to all their information. But absolutely, if they want to interact with me, I'm on Instagram by the same name. I'll give you all my details, and on YouTube too.
Okay, good. Because I think we have to explain to the viewers that it is not a medical advice actually, because many people still think that when we talk in social media, it's for them personally, that we have to explain that there's many things, there's variation of clinical situation and clinical condition, and we cannot just make it the medical advice personally for the people who add the question in the comment. Please, I want to explain this in Indonesia too, so make it more clear. Jadi teman-teman kalau tahu ya bahwa kadang-kadang kita kalau ngirim pesan, komen di YouTube channel gitu kan, tulis komen gitu, itu sebenarnya bukan medical advice, artinya bukan menggantikan diagnosis dokter di klinik gitu. Jadi jangan dipakai sebagai perbandingan atau second opinion gitu, karena itu beda. Itu adalah pengetahuan supaya nanti kalau dokter Anda menjelaskan, Anda tuh agak nyambung gitu. Jadi maksudnya seperti itu. Jadi memang kalau untuk menggantikan diagnosis atau menggantikan pertemuan, telemedicine, menggantikan kita ngobrol dengan orang, itu beda dengan ketemu dengan dokter. Jadi artinya kondisi kita sendiri, clinical condition kita tuh beda dengan apa yang kita lihat di situ. Artinya nggak bisa semerta-merta langsung semua dijiplak begitu aja gitu. Kok nggak pasang ring karena ini? So I just explain to our viewers that when people perhaps they want to ask why the doctors not put a stent in our vessel, that you say that we have to put a stent if your stenosis like narrowing 70%. So it's not really the same thing because maybe you have another situation, perhaps chronic kidney disease or something like that. So they have to think about that. So it's not a personal medical advice.
No, I completely agree. And every individual is unique. You know, some individuals have multiple other conditions that you need to take into account. So like you say, I treat the channel very much as general advice and general information. And it's really important for viewers to take that information and to inform them. But if they do have any specific questions about their own health, it's very important to speak to their own doctor. Because I don't know about you, Dr. Vita, but every time I have a question, be it in medicine or out of medicine, I go on YouTube. I go on YouTube and I find my information there because I think it's such a more interactive way to hear the information, see the information. And it just, you know, I think it's far more engaging. So that's the reason why I created the channel, because there's so much medical information out there that sometimes when you see the same person like yourself speaking about a topic that people enjoy listening to you and the trust develops over time, then I think that can be very worthwhile to inform people. Absolutely.
So yeah, that's why you started your own channel, YouTube channel. Well, actually that's a bold step because, well, I think not really many or really often doctors want to create a YouTube channel because they think that they have no time for that because too many patients, too many cases. But actually, as a doctor, we have we actually have to make a prevention and promotion. So one of our crucial steps as a physician, I mean, it's not just treating patient or manage the patient or just operating for a patient.
Yeah. I mean, I see it as public engagement, and I just see it as a hobby. Really, I enjoy it, and when you enjoy the process. I actually enjoy planning the videos. I enjoy writing the scripts. I enjoy editing the videos afterwards. And I enjoy interacting with the community. And I think ultimately, if you enjoy it, it shows, and you can have that longevity to continue it. So yeah, I think for me, it comes about just for my personal, you know, enjoyment of the whole process. I see it as a creative process. And I think that's one of the reasons why I continue to, you know, really enjoy the process.
Yeah, I can see that you enjoy it because as I said, it's professionally made. I mean, you make it really good, the video. If you didn't have that passion, you will not make it that good. So Dr. Naderi, let's talk about heart disease or something. Well, actually, one in my mind, actually in Indonesia, we have so many people with hypertension and the heart disease. Actually, heart disease is one of top 10 in the disease in Indonesia. So what causes in UK? I think UK people are more educated. I mean, they're not developing country. And then I think they can prevent heart disease, but how's actually the condition there about heart disease in UK?
Yeah, I mean, with regards to hypertension, as I alluded to earlier, it's one of my clinical interests. And actually, I dedicated a series of videos to hypertension on my YouTube channel because there's so much to say. And not only in Indonesia, but I think across the world, including the UK, high blood pressure is the biggest risk factor for heart disease. And we know that it affects at least one in four individuals worldwide. And I think it's not thought about so much, particularly with patients, is because you don't necessarily feel it. You don't necessarily have symptoms with high blood pressure. Usually you feel fine until you develop problems such as heart disease, or you have fatal events like a stroke or a heart attack, and that's one of the reasons why I feel so passionate about it, because high blood pressure can be easily measured at home. And I think one of the positive another positive aspect, the legacy of COVID in the hypertension arena, in my opinion, is home blood pressure monitoring. And interestingly, I was at the British and Irish Hypertension Society annual conference last week. They held it in Brighton, and it was the first in-person conference since the pandemic. And it was really interesting to hear the accounts of my colleagues speaking about how hypertension management has changed so much in terms of the monitoring, because it wasn't possible to bring so many of your patients into clinic and measure their blood pressure. It's turned into an education platform whereby you're teaching patients to take charge of their own health by measuring their blood pressure at home. And I've done a video on this, on exactly step by step on how to do this. So I think that's been a very positive step forward.
So yes, you can watch the video about how to measure your blood pressure because hypertension is one of maybe silent killer in the world. So Anda boleh lihat YouTube-nya Dr. Naderi juga bagaimana cara mengukur tekanan darah ya. Yeah. So yeah, because I thought, well, actually hypertension is maybe one of the oldest disease. I mean, you can actually prevent that. You actually can control it even if you're not having a good diet. Yeah, at least you have the pill. I mean, so I think hypertension will not big challenge in UK, but you say it's on the opposite.
Yes, I think it's a challenge across the world. I think with hypertension, aside from the fact that it's usually asymptomatic, the other challenge is that if you do have high blood pressure, it's a lifelong, we call it a chronic disease. It's something that you should manage throughout your life and maintain. And it's not just about making sure that you take the right medications when it's time to start on medications, but I think more importantly is just making those lifestyle changes, such as exercising regularly and avoiding habits such as smoking or excessive alcohol, and just making sure that you are looking at your life and what you are doing that could potentially be contributing to your blood pressure. So I think a lot of it is just about education, about knowing what things to avoid, what can affect your blood pressure, and also knowing that heart, the abnormal blood pressure not only affects your heart, but other organs as well. It's a multi-system disease. It affects your eyes, could potentially affect your kidneys, and of course your heart. So just being equipped with that knowledge, and knowing what to avoid and what to do about it, I think that's a first step, in my opinion.
And then one thing interested, when people refuse to take a pill for hypertension, they in Indonesia they often say that the pill of hypertension drug will cause them have a kidney failure and then soon have a hemodialysis. Jadi orang sakit minum hipertensi lalu sakit ginjal cuci darah. Is there any thought of that in UK people? I mean, they are, I think, I don't know.
Yeah, I think one of the main challenges when it comes to medications and high blood pressure is non-compliance and non-adherence for exactly those reasons. People don't want to take medications And they feel that it has side effects. And of course, some do have side effects, but it's all a risk balance. When I would think about medication, when I see thickening of the heart, something called left ventricular hypertrophy, because that's when you know that it's affecting the heart, you need to take a bigger step. In most cases, I would recommend lifestyle changes first, unless the blood pressure is very high. But if the lifestyle changes, despite that, the blood pressure is still high, then you would start the medications. And like you say, people are hesitant to start it. For the side effects and the misinformation that's been given to them. So I think that's when it's really important to take time to really explain the rationale and why that medication is being prescribed and briefly how it works. Because with that knowledge, people, when they understand why they need to take it, hopefully that will instill a change in behavior.
No, in Indonesia, we have a statistic. So I forget the exact number, but more than half people who refuse or hesitant to take a pill regularly, it's actually because they're reasoning that they are not really have a symptoms at all. So they refuse to take the pill. So what is the cause or the reason why the UK people do not want to take the pill?
I think it's an issue worldwide and not specific to the UK. I think potentially from the perspective of the patient, when you take the pill, I think it's potentially a psychological thing. You have a disease, right? You need medication to treat a disease. So I think that's when it's really important for the physician, for the doctor, the nurse who's dealing with that patient to really explain the reason why this pill has been prescribed. Because if the person doesn't understand, or if the person isn't sure why it's been prescribed or what it actually does, then of course they're less likely to take it. So I think that's, in my opinion, a really important aspect. What do you think?
Yeah, I think actually interesting with the social aspect. I mean, why people refuse when we give an explanation that you have this high blood pressure and you have to control it? Why? What is the mind behind it? I mean, why they want to resist that? The reality, I mean. So yeah, maybe perhaps that you say that in your experience, they maybe have a denial that they have a disease, perhaps. I don't know. So in Indonesia, several people have that reason too. So they think that when they have a disease, they are prone, and then they're getting old, so they are not complete as a human. So they think that I am not have a disease. So they want to deny that. Yeah, perhaps. So well, actually, it's not specific for UK. I just want to know outside of Indonesian country, what is the reason? Because different country, maybe different reason. I just want to know. Okay, so do they have about education of the people? Yeah, do they have really knowledge about how hypertension, for example, maybe have a target organ damage? So it's not just about heart and kidney, but as well as strokes and the brain, or do they have enough knowledge about that? Because I have research maybe about 5 years or 10 years ago, and they actually, most of the people don't know that hypertension is that dangerous. I mean, hypertension skill, it's very simple, but actually how they damage, that make injury in the organ, they maybe not really know. Based on your experience?
No, I completely agree. And that's one of the reasons why I decided to start the channel, to really educate and raise awareness of high blood pressure. It's not called the silent killer for no reason. There is a rationale behind that. And I think what I've decided to focus on is how am I going to, relay this information, communicate this in the best way possible. And I think it's been my approach to address it in multiple different manners. So firstly, explaining what high blood pressure is, just simply what it is, and why we worry about it, and what steps the individual needs to take to have better control. Because I think information give is one thing, but how can they utilize that for their own good? And then, of course, as I mentioned earlier, during COVID, there was such a big support across the hypertension communities worldwide for home blood pressure monitoring. And that's something that I strongly advocated during the pandemic. And I, as I said, I've done a separate video on that. So I think it's that balance of giving the information, but also making sure that the patient knows how to use it. So what they need to do and how they need to check to make sure that that it's working. And I think home blood pressure monitoring, again, is another way that they can check after a period of time that the intervention that they're doing, be it lifestyle changes or medication, is actually having an impact.
Yeah, well, actually, that is maybe a good coincidence. I mean, the International Society of Hypertension just released a new guideline at the COVID time, I mean, about that home blood pressure monitoring. And then it's helped a lot for people in developing country, because not every center have the same facility. I mean, if you want to close to the target, to the European Society of Hypertension guideline, for example, it's very high. I mean, and then people in several area in the world maybe not that have that facilitation, but there is optimum, and then also there is an ideal target for managing hypertension. So that's very nice. There is a guideline for ISH in 2020. So I want to ask you about home blood pressure monitoring. In UK, is there common, I mean, for people using telemedicine to control blood pressure? Because actually in Indonesia, we just learned to do that, not just the lay patient. I mean, the patient, I mean, for doctors, we have to learn how to control people's blood pressure through telemedicine and then home blood pressure. How about your experience in UK?
Yes, I mean, there's certainly been trials exploring telemedicine and how online education has been very helpful, particularly in the era of COVID, to have better blood pressure control. But I think home blood pressure monitoring, even before COVID, has been used to really address two really important phenomena that occurs in high blood pressure. The first being white coat syndrome. So white coat hypertension, which is relatively common. It affects 30% of patients visiting the clinic. And that simply means that the blood pressure is raised when the patient visits a clinical environment for a number of reasons, be it anxiety or just being in that environment elicits a high blood pressure. And home blood pressure monitoring can be particularly helpful, because if you take that blood pressure reading, which is not their true reading, then you would start medications that would potentially cause low blood pressure, because you haven't found what their true blood pressure reading is. So if you measure blood pressure at home in your own environment over a number of days and take an average, then that addresses white coat syndrome. The other group of individuals that's particularly helpful for is masked hypertension, which is the opposite of white coat syndrome. So individuals who come into the clinic and their blood pressure is actually lower than their true reading. And there are various schools of thought of why this occurs. And I think about masked hypertension, particularly in individuals who have risk factors for heart disease, such as, you know, they may be having high cholesterol, or they've had a heart attack in the past, but their blood pressure is normal. So that does make me suspicious. So when you ask them to measure their blood pressure at home, that unmasks the true reading. So you find that actually the blood pressure is higher than it should be, and you need to introduce intervention. So I think not only home blood pressure monitoring is helpful because it's convenient for the patient, is empowering because you learn a new skill, but also it's helpful in certain situations that we see in high blood pressure.
Well, actually, in Indonesia, it's very relevant because nowadays, recently, I mean, in Indonesia, we are pushing for vaccination coverage, and then hypertension is one of most common reason why people cannot be vaccinated because they have really high blood pressure when they come to the vaccination post. And then hypertension is one of the top three comorbidity. I mean, beside of heart disease and also obesity, and then they have a common in France. I mean, hypertension usually came with heart disease and vice versa. So, well, I don't know in UK, based on your experiences, that hypertension is really serious in this pandemic era as well? I mean, just like ours in Indonesia?
Yeah, I mean, I think what the pandemic has really taught us is that when we were trying to manage this communicable, this contagious disease, it's really shed light on the importance of non-communicable diseases, yes, such as heart disease.
Yes.
That's a really interesting paradox, almost, that heart disease is an important risk factor for the survival of patients. And we know that from the data. So we know that a weaker heart, so individuals with heart failure do worse with COVID, and they have worse prognosis. And, you know, it's really helped to shed light on keeping on top of your blood pressure and why that's important to reduce your risk of, you know, now COVID, because it's, you know, high blood pressure can cause heart disease and that sequelae. So, you know, similar story in the UK and across the world. And I think what this has just done is really shed light on the importance of lifestyle changes, which has been so important as we come out of this pandemic.
So this is a message for our lay viewers, then maybe they don't think that their common habit will become hypertension or heart disease. So in my opinion, people now have a new habit. Maybe they came for work from home disease, and then they will have maybe non-stop Zoom meeting, Zoominars, webinars, and it's very exhausted. And then they will came for Netflix maybe every day, every single night, and then they will not have a regular sleeping time, and then that will trigger hypertension, high blood pressure, stress, and then or so on, so on. So what do you think, and what's your message for people now to have their blood pressure controlled?
Yeah, absolutely. I think we know that blood pressure is as a result of a number of factors. So we know that it's partly related to your genetics, partly related to your lifestyle, and in some cases due to an underlying condition in secondary hypertension, for example. But the majority of people will have primary or essential hypertension, and that's that interplay between lifestyle and genetics. Genetics we can't do much about, it's inherited, whereas the lifestyle factors we have, you know, certain degree of control over. And what I think that my messaging through my social media outlets has really been to look at your lifestyle, you know, like you say, assess your daily habits. You know, what do you do during the day? Are you taking time out to exercise? And are you indulging in activities such as smoking, which at any amount will cause issues, and it's never too late to stop. So I think it's just about making those important changes first, and then reassessing to see if medication is required. And I did explain that in some instances, medication is required from the beginning, in cases of very high blood pressure. But I do always encourage to make lifestyle changes first, because I think that's you can maintain that. And if you need medication, that can be a second step.
And then it's actually a pivotal point, because when you have a lifestyle modification, you have to do that even if you with drugs, I mean, with medicines or without medicine. I mean, even if you take the pill or not take the pill, you still have to have that lifestyle modification. I mean, like doing exercise and have a better sleep regulation. I mean, yeah, have a sleeping time properly. And I think, well, I mean, if you have a genetic of hypertension, but you have a good lifestyle, I mean, you have lower your risk to have a hypertension or heart disease in the future still. So you still have hope. I mean, many of people still that, oh, my father or my dad or my mother have hypertension, so I will actually have it one time in the future. So it's not really necessary like that, right? You still have hope.
I agree. Yeah, absolutely. I think it's important to, like you say, look at your lifestyle first, and just ensure that you are optimizing, doing your exercise, looking at what you're eating, because we know that in particular salt intake contributes very heavily to blood pressure, and avoiding habits that we've touched upon. But I think if that's taken care of, and still your blood pressure is high, then we can explore medication options. But it's all about making those small steps first, achievable goals, and then, taking the next step if it's necessary.
And then this one for last thing, what is your advice? How you tell people to have a medical or heart checkup? Because in Indonesia, some of the people think that when you have medical checkup, you will have the disease revealed. So it's better if you don't know the disease. It's actually the thing that they think that if they don't know about the disease does not exist. It's actually the opposite. I mean, when you know the disease and then it's become complicated, it's actually more and more stressful for the patient and for the doctors. So how do you tell your patient in UK there about that?
Ignorance can be bliss at times, but I think with certain disease processes, like you say, the longer you leave it, the more difficult it is to treat. So I think with things like blood pressure, if it's treated early, then it might just be the lifestyle changes that will, correct the blood pressure. But if you leave it for a long time, then you may have catastrophic events like a heart attack or a stroke. And that's, of course, something that we want to avoid. So, of course, I would say if you're having symptoms, definitely get yourself checked out. Go to your general practitioner or your family doctor in the first instance, and they will, direct you to the right person afterwards if they need to. But I would say if you are asymptomatic, and certainly at a certain age, we do encourage you to get annual checks. I think it really does depend on person to person. So it depends on your lifestyle, what other medical problems you have. But I would say certainly if you're symptomatic, you should certainly visit your family physician.
Oh, that's a strong message. Thank you very much. So we'll actually do what the theme of World Heart Day now this year, that they call that use heart to connect. And then so we use that now by Zoom meeting, and then we can collaboration to educate people. Well, actually, I have more questions for you, but I think I already disturbed you too much today. It's too long. I already promised to you that we have already just half an hour, and then we more than that, actually.
No, it's been an absolute pleasure speaking with you, Dr. Vito. And thanks again for having me on your channel. And what you do in terms of educating individuals in Asia and Indonesia, it's so important. And please continue, do what you're doing.
Yeah, you as well. And I looking forward to do this again, maybe another theme about heart disease, and we can collaboration more. And then for you, the viewers today, you can feel that you can watch the YouTube channel, Dr. Habib Naderi from London, about heart disease. Very good channel, very interesting. And really, really good one. I mean, visualization and, very good. So, yeah, Dr. Habib Naderi, we will talk about this again, maybe after one episode, two episodes, or three episodes more after this. Thank you very much. And see you. Stay healthy.
Thank you.
Dapatkan informasi medis langsung dari dokter Tito dengan subscribe channel YouTube ini. Anda juga bisa membagikan semua informasi berharga di sini dengan cara share ke teman-teman atau kenalan Anda.